Alright y'all, here we are. This is January the 28th, 2017, and we are in Brentwood, Tennessee, and I am real proud to say that we have collected some real valiant warriors here in Tennessee, people who have been affected in their life by CPS, DCS, family court system. We've been sort of congealing over the past 2 years. I have been working at this for 20 years. But through social media, we have been able to collect as a group with different talents, different needs, different strengths. And so this is our first meeting for 2017. We are streaming this live so you can see what we're talking about, what kind of things we're doing. I've already got, and if you can just kind of shift the camera down there, I've already got several people who are stuffing envelopes. And we're going to do letters to President Trump, and we're going to talk about that, and we're going to talk about other contacts. So I did pass around, did everybody get a copy of this little packet? This is like the real, just the real nuts and bolts of information that I want you to have as you walk out of here today. Study it, learn it. These are just the valuable information that you need to know. Also, I passed around an agenda for today so we can talk about, we can sort of put some organization to what we're talking about. I do have a few things, extra things that I printed out to give you some other direction. But the first thing I want to talk about today is what is the movement. So the problem is the federal funding of the child welfare system. It has been at 40, 50 years in the making where the federal government has taken more and more control over our children through education, through medical, through child welfare. And I know one of the things I posted this morning, because I've been telling everybody this, the privatization is going to overwhelm our whole entire family structure, including education. So paying attention to what's going on in the child welfare agencies is very important so that people get into their heart and get active about it. I am Connie Reguli. Most of the people through Facebook know who I am. I've been an attorney in private practice for over 20 years. I went back to law school late in life. It was a second career for me. My family was in the restaurant business for 20 years, so I understand business and being out in the real world and being in government. The real world is much nicer, by the way. So I started as a prosecutor. I prosecuted domestic violence and child abuse. My very first jury trial was a death of a baby. So I always want to tell people that, because I want people to understand I know what real child abuse looks like. I understand what burns on a child's hands and real bruises to their brain look like. And I have prosecuted and stood up in front of a jury and told them that that person needed to go to jail for life. But I have also been in private practice where I've been dealing with families and children who have gotten stuck in this system that is devastating. And at first I didn't understand it. I mean, I got into it right when the whole Brian A. class action, children getting lost in foster care, that was in the late 90s. And then there started to be this shift. And the shift came with ASPA. We're going to talk more about that in a minute. But now, where we are today, 2017, if we do not make some dynamic changes in the family court system and the child welfare system, we're at a loss, okay? I mean, I think about the Holocaust all the time. I think about the Jews who were walked away from their homes and nobody said anything. I mean, maybe if they had social media back then and people could collect and unite their brains and their efforts, it would have been different. But they were literally carried away like sheep. And the laws of the country allowed it to happen. There was a great article in the American Bar Association Journal in 2011, and it talked about how everything that happened in Nazi Germany was legal. And what they did is they trapped attorneys into this system where the attorneys had to go along with the system. Does this sound familiar? Anybody?
Yes.
Had to go
yes.
along. The attorneys had to go along or they would be impugned. The judges were aristocratic, and they would punish attorneys, okay, if they stood up for their clients. I have been called a jerk in the courtroom by a judge when I stood up for my client. I have been found in contempt because I stood up for my client and wouldn't let a judge unilaterally make decisions about my client's case. So that is why I am here. I have seen the devastating effect on families. You know, my family just kind of skirted on it, sort of touched on it, just because I had teenage girls that were kind of unruly and, you know, ended up getting caught up in the system a little bit. But most of the time I've dealt with families. I've probably dealt with 1,000 families at least all over the state of Tennessee. I've been to Maryland. I've been to Kentucky. I've been to South Carolina. So that is why I'm here. I think that it's time for a change. I think we can find leaders in this change, and there's ways to do it. Now, why you are here, all right? Everybody's here for a little bit different reason. Some people because their very family has been touched by this. Some people because they recognize this problem and they want to be dynamic part of the change. Some people because you have a conservative heart and you want the government out of family lives generally. Some people who want to take some leadership in this. Now, how we arrived here, as I've already said, there have been layers and layers of legislation. One of the things that I have provided to you is for you to take a look at, and I'm going to scan this all together and I'm going to post it up in files in the Family Forward project and in Innocent Families. But this is a timeline of the child welfare legislation. Now, they've got in this chart that it goes back to 1935. When the Social Security Act included funds for child welfare services under Title V, okay? But very little really happened until we get into the 70s. In 1974 was CAPTA, C-A-P-T-A, which is the Child Abuse Prevention and Treatment Act. That really started a flood of funding going into the system. And that was really the funding that started really supporting this foster care network. So you need to understand, as a country, we used to have orphanages, okay? There used to be orphanages all over the country, and there used to be homes for unwed mothers, okay? If a teenager got pregnant in the 1960s, she didn't dare stay home and have a baby in her neighborhood. She had to go to a home for unwed mothers. There are tragic stories about homes for unwed mothers stealing the children and placing them for adoption. It's happened all over the world. But as the government kind of let go of having orphanages, then they started really pushing foster care. And of course, at the very beginning, it was all government-run foster care. Well, you know, the government doesn't really do anything very well. So, of course, they did not do foster care very well. By the 1990s, by the 1980s, early 90s, is when children were lost in the foster care system forever. They would lose them. They didn't even know who they were, where they were, what their names were. They just totally lost them. And that is what spawned a series of class action suits across the United States, including Tennessee. And in Tennessee, it's called the Brian A. case, which started in the early 90s. And it ended with it's ongoing, actually. But the result was a consent decree, which said that DCS is going to do certain things. Now, that all sounds well and good because those certain things started this accountability. Now, everybody here that's dealt with DCS in the last 4 or 5 years are going to go, accountability, that ain't working. Right. And as a matter of fact, I pulled up the 2015 consent decree, and there are some very specific things in there. And I took one case I have, just one single case, and I contacted the Children's Rights Organization, and I contacted the Brian A. Monitor, and I said, DCS is in violation of page 7, paragraph 2, page 8, paragraph 9, page 12, paragraph 3. I said, do you care? And they said no. Okay? Because the one big gap in that whole plan is that there was no accountability to the public. There is no reporting mechanism for parents. I have many times contacted DCS and I had said, I want to file a complaint against a social worker. Who do I file a complaint to? Well, you tell their supervisor, and then their supervisor will tell the regional, and I'm ain't going to work.
It's a vicious cycle, and then you have retaliation. Right. There.
Right. I'm like, I want to go to the top. What is the complaint for, what is the process for filing a complaint at the top? And they said, we don't have one. That was probably 3 or 4 years ago. Even more recently, within the last year, I contacted DCS, and I wrote a letter, and I said, this client has come to me that they're in violation of the Brian A. agreement, and I want a parent advocate for this client. I want you to hire somebody who's going to advocate for this parent. when she goes to a CFTN meeting, when she's trying to meet the requirements of the plan. I want an advocate. I got a very nice letter from legal at VCS and said, well, you know, we don't really have anybody who can fill that role. All right? Big gap in the entire system is parent advocacy. So this legislation goes on and on and on. I told you this is your the Bible of your information. You do not have to memorize all these laws. This is not, I'm not going to quiz you on this. But what is important is that you go through here and you move up to 1997. The demon law is the 1997 Adoption and Safe Families Act. As these class actions started congealing in different states, and there are probably about 7 or 8 states that it happened in, Congress, in all of its infinite wisdom, and Bill Clinton and Hillary Clinton, decided this: what we need to do is we need to provide incentives for children to have permanency, to move out of the foster care system and get into adoptive homes. Because quite honestly, 40 years ago, not very many people adopted children out of DCS. It just didn't happen, okay? So they're like, they started this big, huge promotion. The state started getting a bonus check. The state got a $4,000 bonus check for every child that was adopted out, and if it was considered a special needs child, then it was a $6,000 bonus check. Special needs could be a child over 9. It could be a child of a sibling group of more than 3. It could be an African-American child. It could be a child who was diagnosed with any disability, including ADD, ADHD, anything, which you can just about tag any 7-year-old with these days, right, if you really want to.
That played right into the hand of Big Pharma.
Intelligence, overly intelligent. So,
certain categories for special needs.
Right. So if it was a special needs child, they got the bonus. So that created a whole new incentive. Another thing that started happening about that same time period is privatization. Privatization of foster care and of the related DCS services. So we have bonus money to the states, Title IV-E money for an endless amount of money to go to foster care, and we have privatization. As this all come together, these state agencies, which are part of the executive branch of your government, it means your governor is in control of the department, the agency in each and every state. But who does the budget for the state? The General Assembly or legislature,
yep.
Right? So you have the executive branch and the legislative branch. Okay, so what does the legislative branch have to do? They have to balance the budget. Now, I started going to the legislature 8 years ago, and I said, DCS is not working. I need you to pull this case and review this case. I need you to look at this. We need new laws. They're like, oh, it's horrible. Oh, yeah, they're horrible. Wouldn't do a thing. I didn't know why. Couldn't figure it out until I looked at the budget. All right? So when you look at the budget, and this is they quit publishing this. When they see I'm starting to pull things off the internet, they quit providing them. So this is a 2014 budget for DCS funding sources. Now, if you're in another state and you're watching this, I'm going to promise you that your state is in the very same predicament. Because if you look at this nice little pie chart, what you're going to find in this nice little pie chart is about 42% of the state budget for the Child Welfare Agency comes from the federal government. So they can't cut a dollar out of their budget without losing $2, right? Now, it also means that they have to do what the federal government tells them to do as part of that budgeting. So Title IV-E money is directly associated and tied to foster care. So that is number one. Title.
I actually did a research paper on this topic.
She what?
I actually did a research paper on this topic.
Great.
For a history class.
Oh, good.
Publish it.
Yeah.
I did online.
All right, so Title IV-E money. Title IV-E money is
I gave it away for
you. Is it a use it or lose it funding scheme? Okay, so each state must use all the funds that they're given in 1 year to be able to get the same amount for the next year. All right, so problem number one. Problem number two is it's endless.
Yeah.
Problem number three is it's 42% of the state budget. So The way you find out, how is this affecting my state? And again, it doesn't matter what state you're in, the theme is the same in every single state in the United States. You can go to a website called kidscount.org. Now, kidscount.org is created by and maintained by the Casey Foundation, which is a foundation that was started by the head of UPS, had a good intent, was to reduce foster care. Well, it doesn't really have, hasn't really done a whole lot to that effect, but I mean, it's somewhere at the commencement of this, there was a good heart in it. But kidscount.org is a great source for statistics. You can go to that website, you can find your state, you can scroll down to all these stats on children. The number of children that are in kindergarten, the number of children in high school, you can scroll, scroll, scroll. As you scroll down the page, you're going to find some important stats. And those stats are children entering foster care, children in foster care, children exiting foster care. You can do a 5-year bar chart. So you do a 5-year bar chart, and you're going to find there's some number, magic number, and every year for your state, it may look like this, but it is going to be consistent every single year. For Tennessee, the magic number is 8,000. So for the state of Tennessee, they must have 8,000 children in the foster care system every year just to maintain their level of Title IV funds that they're getting. Now, the second part of that, of funding, is...
They have to do it at the end of the year, too, so it gives them a bigger baseline.
Exactly. It's Title IV-B. Now, one of the first ways I found out what was going on is I worked in a certain case. I worked with this doctor in the head of a sociology department in the University of Michigan. It was a sexual abuse case, but she had written a book about it. But I just emailed her one day, and I said, you know, I'm having a really hard time figuring out why children are being moved through foster care and not the families are not being rehabilitated. I have workers over here who need something to do, so give them some envelopes to stuff or something. But
papers to fold.
Papers to fold.
Papers to fold.
Would you go back to the copy issue? Mm-hmm. Because I printed about 50 more letters. So she sent me a very simple email that said, the problem is Title IV-E money is endless, is not capped, and Title IV-B is capped. Mm-hmm. So I said, okay, what is Title IV-B? Title IV-B is the rehabilitation, reunification, family stability, unification money. It is limited on what the states can spend it for. Now, Title IV-E is limited, and they cannot even use money for any rehabilitation or reunification services unless the child is in foster care. So they can't even take the child and put the child back in their home and continue services and get Title IV-E money. It is only if that child is in foster care. So there creates another problem.
That's why they delay.
Now I have the chart from there's a lot of government resources. You have to dig and pull and dig and pull and research and find and save and read through 70 pages of a congressional report to be able to collect all this information. But what you will find when you get to the bottom of it is that this money is $8 billion. This money is $800 million. So what we have is one-tenth. So 10 times the amount of money that is going for family rehabilitation or family reunification, 10 times that amount is gone to foster care and forced adoptions. There is no way out of this problem until that is ended. That is ended. Now, what we're doing today, one of the things we're doing today is we're doing a letter, and I've posted it on Twitter under #MyExecutiveOrder and #BanAsFA. Here is the number one thing that I think we should focus on to begin to make a dent, and that is to get our government to ban adoption bonuses. It is against humanity to put a price tag on a child's head, to socially engineer that child's family genealogy. there is no doubt about it. There is no other way to explain it. That bonus money is a crime against humanity. What we are doing, and what I've got everybody doing today, let me give you one of those, is we're doing a letter. I posted on the Family Forward Project last night an email link and the language to put in the email to the White House. We're also doing letters, and this is what the letter reads. Dear President Donald J. Trump, every year in America, 400,000 children are living in foster care. Every child deserves to be safe and loved, but statistics show that 80% of these children are removed from their homes on the ambiguous and innocuous claims of child neglect. How can this happen in America? Our leaders in government have cast layers of legislation on child welfare for 50 years. The result is a system of federal funding that rewards state agencies financially for placing children in foster care rather than rehabilitating families. The state agencies are now overwhelmed by the force of private contractors controlling foster care and profiting off our children. The state agencies refuse to make changes because they are financially dependent on the federal funds that pay them to take children. Bill Clinton's Adoption and Safe Families Act of 1997 put a price tag on the head of every child for child welfare agencies to take children and socially engineer their future by adopting them into the homes of strangers. Please stop. Ask for money now. Please execute an executive order which prohibits the adoption bonus program to the states for forced adoptions. Thousands of voters on social media who are suffering from the trauma of family destruction caused by child welfare agencies have supported you in this election. ASFA is a monetary scheme, is against humanity and the constitutional right of family integrity. Our children are not for sale. There are many professional experts who can educate you on this giant problem. These professionals can enlighten you on the burdens of this system. And then I went ahead and I listed people that I've contacted through social media. I've listed myself. Molly Tierney is a commissioner in Maryland. Sean McMillan, of course, anybody on social media is aware of him. Joe Churchwell is an attorney in Arkansas. Julie Ketterman is an attorney in Texas. Lisa Vincent, an attorney in Connecticut. Terry LaPointe is a writer for medicalkidnap.com. Diane Redleaf is an attorney in Illinois. And there are many, many more. Now, I also want to tell you, this isn't the end of the money chain, okay? This is not the end. There is also, as I put on your list here, Title 4D money. I don't like red today. That's purple. Now, what is Title 4D money? Title 4D money is child support money. All right, so under Title 4 is the Social Security Act, by the way. Social Security Act, you know what that tells you. It's part of your Social Security trust money. I'm going in part of this here. This is the Title 4D money. So now there's a child support scheme. So this federal government started paying the states money to enforce and collect child support. Okay? So now they have rules. If you want to get your Title 4D money, there's other rules. What are one of those rules? One of the rules is that if you take a child and put him in foster care within 10 days, you need to go after that parent, pay the state child support.
Yep, I do that too.
Yep. Child
support. Does that include kinship foster care as well, or just with foster care?
Well, I'm paying child support on one of my two children.
Yeah. Well, I mean, child support for any of them.
So kinship, yeah. Right. Under that.
Now, Title 4D money is also a very strange animal because there's bonuses associated with Title 4D money. Based upon the amount of dollars that you collect and the amount of dollars that basically you assess, okay? So what this means is that they just assessing money, if they build up this huge debt, I mean child support debt, in America is huge. It's fake money. It's not real money most of the time. There's a lot of people out there that gets these huge child support assessments and who end up with judgments. Their kid turns 18 and they've got a $70,000, $80,000, $100,000 judgment against them.
Yep.
which they can take their license, and that's a whole nother topic I can talk to you about sometime. But that money also is tied in to the Title IV-E and Title IV-B. There's also Title X money. Title X money is family planning clinics that ensure a broad range of family planning and preventative health services, it says, but that crosses over into child welfare. And here's another really big one, which is Title 19. This is the Medicaid money.
Oh, wow. Okay.
All right, so now they have, basically, once a child comes into the welfare system, the state agency has a blank check to put that child on any kind of medication, to get them any kind of services. For those of you who have been involved and your children have been taken to foster care, have you noticed how all of a sudden they have a slew of doctor's appointments?
Yep.
They're like getting their hearing check, their eyes check, their speech check, their genetics check.
They're diagnosed this, they're diagnosed that.
So that is all related because, again, if they can get them in that special needs class and they adopt them out, they get extra bonus money, and plus they have an endless checkbook for Title 19 money. Now, the private contractors. This is one that is really, I'm grinding my teeth about these days.
You wrote asses there. Was that a Freudian slip? You're supposed
yes,
to
it,
write
it really
assess,
was,
and you wrote
was.
Asses.
Yes.
Probably.
It was appropriate, though.
Yes. For the world. Private contractors. There has been enough scuttle. This is why I was never a teacher. There's been enough scuttle in the news about the prison system, the private prison system, how they're going to eliminate the private prison system, how the prison system does this and does that, people wrongfully being incarcerated. Our prison population since the 1970s has skyrocketed. Now, I have been a prosecutor, and I understand crime and putting people in jail, but I'm also going to tell you here today, in case anybody doesn't know this, a lot of people are wrongly convicted. A lot of people. And a lot of people go to jail for crimes that are created crimes, okay? And I'm not going to spend a lot of time talking about that. But it's activities and it's things that it's a crime, not because it's a crime against humanity or persons or property, but just because the government makes it a crime, all right? Whole nother conversation. But private contractors. So now we have in the child welfare system private contractors doing foster care, doing therapy, doing family assessments. Let's see if I can not spell
S.
I kind of like the way she did the first time.
Yeah, it was appropriate.
Okay, and it goes on and on and on. Okay. Anybody who's in business, who's ever worked with any type of government or anything, I mean, even attorneys, there's this huge thing out there called conflict of interest, right? Conflict of interest. So you have one private contractor, and I'm going to take the one I like to hit on these days. The biggest one in Tennessee is Omni. Now, Omni was created and run by Jim Henry. Jim Henry out of East Tennessee, who also, after he had established a few contracts with the Department of Children's Services, became, thanks to Governor Haslam, his friend from East Tennessee, became the commissioner of the Department of Children's Services in 2011. Mr. Henry says, but he sold his interest in Omni, right? That's what the newspaper said. So he, from 2011 and I think it's 2015, served as commissioner. During that time period, Omni, I'm going to tell you how I know this, because I know this for a fact, $253 million from the Tennessee taxpayers.
Oh, my word.
Now, how do I know that, right? Connie, how can you speed that out? So there's this great thing, and for Tennessee, it's called the Open Checkbook. You can go to Tennessee, transparenttennessee.gov, something like that, scroll down to the bottom, it's got the Tennessee checkbook. And you can go to the Tennessee checkbook, and you can sort, and you can put in the agency, you can put in the vendor, you can put in the year range, and that's what I did. And so I went from 2011 to 2015 For OmniVisions, what was the amount of money received from the Department of Children's Services?
It's visible. The visible amount.
That's visible.
Yeah,
right.
They have other sub-entity names.
And they subcontract and
right.
stuff as well. So at least $253 million.
Right.
All
right,
so in 2015, and it's really funny because I started posting about 2014 that about this whole conflict with on the internet, and Jim Henry goes from commissioner of DCS to Haslam's chief of staff. Now, that's a $60,000 a year pay cut. So why would you take a $60,000 a year pay cut if it didn't matter, right? Now we have Bonnie Homrick, who, I don't even know what she's doing. She's a mess, but she is, this is controlling. Omni's controlling. And Camelot, those are the two largest ones.
And they're expanding with the Medicaid program, expanding to do mental health services.
Yes.
If you research, and are you getting there?
Oh, yeah.
Be quiet?
Okay. Yeah, yeah. Yeah, they're now taking control. And I'm going to tell you, I go to a few CFTM meetings with my clients. I went to a recent one. There were six people from Omni at this meeting.
Man. Oh, wow.
Six people, one parent.
Different titles, though. Different.
Oh, yeah.
As
a caseworker, the therapist,
right.
the regional supervisor, or the district supervisor, there's six people from Omni.
Very intimidating.
Yeah. Not to count the other eight people from DCS and a parent and their attorney. Thank goodness.
Can I ask a question?
Yeah.
I have a counselor with Camelot. She's my therapist, and she says she doesn't know the laws about testifying on my behalf. Is there a law saying that she cannot testify?
No, there's not a law saying she cannot testify. All right, so now Omni, in this particular case, has taken over the foster care, the therapy, the family assessment, the whole thing. Total conflict of interest. I said in a meeting, I said, I have a problem here. There's a conflict of interest with Omni doing all these things. And they're like, well, you'll have to take that up to the commissioner. Or a letter to the commissioner. Or the conflict of interest. Not a reply.
Nope.
Not a.
I did that.
All right, so you have the conflict with the private agencies. But here's something else.
And they're for-profit. That's important.
Oh, and they're for-profit, of course.
Yes, they're for-profit corporations.
They are for-profit corporations. DCS. Every state's a little different. DCS, DCF, DC, whatever, okay? Family Services. Every state's got a few different initials in it. Child Protective Services. Everybody knows that. CPS. In every single state, the CPS agency has two diametrically opposed functions. I served as a district attorney. The public defender defended the people who'd been charged with crimes. The twain shall never meet, okay? We didn't share the same office. We didn't talk to each other about our client's secret information, all right? It was a pull and a pull. You cannot have a balance until you have two antagonistic forces pulling in different directions. DCS, one agency, one commissioner, one head, one budget, does prosecution of parents and destruction of family. I know so many people who have called me and have said, I called DCS myself. I want to help. You know, my child told me this. My teenage daughters need some help.
That's how mine started.
My sibling, my two kids, one of them reported this. I need some help.
And you're bound by law as well, right?
Well, you're not. Parents are not mandatory reporters, but I need help. I need services. And it becomes a prosecution and destruction.
It sure does.
Until we break this up and make this two separate government agencies. We will never get past this problem. Never get past this problem. We have to have family prosecution, parent prosecution as a separate individual agency associated with law enforcement and the district attorney's office.
Agreed. And that goes on for years. It doesn't matter if you asked for help 20 years ago.
Yeah.
They prosecute you now.
And I want to.
It never goes away.
And I want to give you an example that Jenny brought to my attention this morning. And again, having a sort of law enforcement prosecution background, this just drives me crazy as well. There's a thing in Tennessee law. Every state has one. It's a little bit different. It's called SIPET. A SIPET meeting is DCS workers meeting with the DA. It's called a SIPET meeting for them to decide whether or not to prosecute criminally. Now, the DA doesn't investigate. The law enforcement hasn't investigated. As a matter of fact, you call law enforcement and you say, you know, there's a suspected child sexual abuse, they'll say call DCS, right?
Yep. Yeah.
These SIPET meetings, the DA is totally relying on the information and the investigation of DCS. They do not do their independent investigation. Law enforcement's not done an independent investigation. They are 100% reliant upon what DCS tells them. The same DCS who has a financial incentive to destroy the family, take the child, put the child in an adoptive home. When you stand back and you look at this, if you told this story about how this happens, you would say, this doesn't happen in America.
Exactly.
This is like Venezuela.
Yeah,
I don't want to dog any country.
Yeah.
Because it's so horrid.
It really is.
But this is like some third world country. This is like, this must be a government that's ruled by like some
Hitler.
Right.
Yes.
Or Assad, or whatever the guy's name is, over in Syria. This must be going on in Syria, not in America.
No, this is sophisticated. It is American.
This will be the end of the American family. It will be.
You sure got a good start going.
Well, no, I don't think they are only dealing with perhaps 3% of our population. We're very small.
So far.
So we don't have a voice.
Right,
it's
right.
Got to grow like anything else.
So far, okay?
It can grow.
So far.
So fast.
Yes. Yes. Because it will grow. That number for Tennessee, they have now. So how does it grow? I've got a PowerPoint on this presentation too. How do they keep that? And that's a number, not a dollar. You've got to keep that. What do they have to do? Who do they have to engage in this process to make sure that they have 8,000 children a year? Top judges. The judges have to engage in this process. Now, the judges have a financial incentive, too, because there's the court improvement program, the blah, blah, blah. They get all this other kind of money for themselves and to hire extra staff. The judges appoint the GALs, guardian ad litem, and the parents attorneys.
They all work for the same.
And these are like interchangeable, okay? So on one case, they may serve as GAL, and another case, they serve as a parents attorney, all right? And most of the time, under the same judge. So you have, and you know, I've been fresh out of law school before, so you know, I know it's kind of hard to get into the business, but you have these fresh out of law school students who never tried a case in their life. And they go up to the juvenile court judge and now say, I'll take some appointments. All right, so you have bar number, you know, 4, 6, you know, fresh out of law school, you know, just past the bar, law number. And they take a parent attorney appointment. What do they start to do? They are clueless. Because let me tell you, DCS is a well-oiled machine.
Mm-hmm.
A well-oiled machine. They are limited on what they can make Even in the toughest cases, they can only make $1,500, which is at $40 an hour. Now, you can deliver mail, probably, and make $40 an hour, right? So, they have no experience. They have limited amount of funds.
It quit.
Uh-oh.
This one's still going on.
All right. Well, that one's still going on, and you're on.
Yes.
It is?
That's
okay.
For recording?
No.
Wow.
That's okay. You're good over there. All right. So, so they take a case, and they don't know what to do. They don't even know what to do. Many of these attorneys do not even ask for the DCS records. They don't even ask. Many of these attorneys don't ask for the forensic interviews of the children. They just don't even ask.
They don't even offer to attend these meetings.
They don't go to the meetings. Why? Because they don't make any money. No. They won't even go to the meetings. No meetings.
And when they do show up, that's when everything just didn't work out that day at CPS.
Right.
And you 5 minutes after getting there, you leave.
Yeah. Yeah. Now, here's another thing. If they want to be reappointed by that judge and get another case, you don't want to make the judge work too hard now. Don't want to make the judge work too hard. Much, much easier to settle the case. Judges like attorneys who settle the cases. So these court-appointed attorneys convince their clients to settle. We're gonna do this. We're gonna stipulate to dependent neglect so they can put you on a plan to get your children back. Happens all the time. Now that has saved the judge a 2 or 3 day trial. It has gotten them another appointment down the line. They can move on. They've not had to expend over their $1,500 limit and take another case. So the judge is buying into it. Who else is buying into this? Not going to like this. I'm just going to use one specific example. I'm going to call up Vandy or Vanderbilt, but I'm going to tell you what the class is. The new medical certification called a child abuse expert. A child abuse expert is a pediatrician who does a fellowship, who follows around another, goes to some hospital, follows around another person who's already got this certification as a child abuse expert for about a year and a half, then they become a child abuse expert. Child abuse experts look for abuse, okay? They are hired by the hospital. We have them here at Vanderbilt. They have them at East Tennessee. We have them down in Chattanooga. They are trained and paid to diagnose non-accidental trauma or child abuse. Shaken Baby is the one that's just going all over the place right now.
Non-accidental
trauma.
That makes sense.
Okay, so they have to buy into this program because they understand the deal. For instance, in the Vanderbilt expert, who is the child abuse expert, guess what? She has a contract with DCS to do the reviews of the child deaths. So she's making money. It's her partner in crime here. All right, so they have to buy into it. Now, the parents, then you also have, we can talk about CASA and some other things, but the parent is really out here alone. Because everybody wants to protect the best interest in the child. They forget that there's constitutional rights to parents, the rehabilitation. There's also a constitutional right to family integrity. Family integrity. Your children have a right to know who their parents are.
And their siblings, right?
And their siblings. Family integrity. Mm-hmm. And that's one of the things we're also... Grandparents.
Yeah.
The entire family unit.
That's something else that needs to be addressed is grandparent rights.
There are 400,000 children in foster care in any given day, but think about it. Every one of those children has two parents and a mom and a dad, has at least a couple grandparents out there.
Or more.
Yeah. May have a couple siblings.
Aunts,
two,
uncles.
Three, four siblings.
Nieces, nephews, cousins.
Nieces, nephews. Okay.
All cut off.
All cut off. There's got to be over 4 million people affected on any given day.
Instantly.
Every day.
And we talked about the number growing, and that 400,000, those children are suffering psychological trauma that will live with them forever. At least half of them have long-lasting effects. So
passing it on to the next generation.
That's
too.
Right. And become victims of the system.
Right. And so what we were talking about is, how does that number grow? That number grows is because the threshold comes down. Because they know they have to keep those kids in the system, so the threshold comes down.
That's right.
I just had a case come out by the Court of Appeals. I'm like jaw-dropping. Poor kid, young kid, teenagers get pregnant, right? They're not living together. Different states. She moves back to Tennessee. She uses some marijuana or some pain pills while she's pregnant. A little baby breaks up with her, right? Now, when the baby's 10 months old, the baby truly gets injured, no doubt about it, in mom's care. However, they found the father, who was in Michigan when this occurred, in Michigan from the time the woman was 2 months pregnant and she was in Tennessee, they found that he was guilty of severe abuse because he had knowledge that when she was 2 months pregnant, she used an illegal drug, which is severe abuse, and he knowingly did not legally intervene while she was pregnant. What can you do? What kind of legal action do you take while somebody is pregnant? Now, what has happened is now a judge determined that. That judge has created a new standard for DCS to hang their hat on.
This is a recent case, right?
This is brand new. Mm-hmm. That judge has created a whole new standard.
That's the predictability that you...
But a whole new standard that DCS can now take on every single case. Parties are not married. You know, there's a baby.
That's why I say you have a mandatory... Parents are mandated to report because this is the result of not reporting something that you may or may not know is a...
But they're not mandated reporters.
I understand. But they're
right.
Treating you like a
conflict
mandated
of interest.
Reporter.
Now, let me tell you what else. Because this... 20-year-old kid has a severe abuse finding against him in the state of Tennessee that follows him the rest of his life.
Are the same people that will say that man had no right to tell that woman what to do because that baby was a part of her body.
Right.
He has been judicially castrated. There's another case that came out this year that confirmed this.
Would you agree that in that process for that case, was there due process for this father? There couldn't have been if he was absent
in family court.
But I'm saying he was absent for half of the proceeding, right? Like he wasn't involved in the initial.
Well, initially, right, right.
But
ultimately,
so
unbalanced. Right. Ultimately, this ruling that he should have known. He should have known, right? And you're right. What's he going to do? Go get a declaratory judgment that she needs to mandate that she gets an abortion?
Was she prosecuted?
Yes, she was.
Okay.
Yes.
And her argument was, he should have told me.
Yeah.
So he was, is that how he was brought into it?
He told me.
Yeah.
That was her defense?
Well, actually, the baby was injured at 10 months old because mom goes on a drug rage and the baby gets hurt, not real severe, but it was true injury. And so they went against the mom. They took the baby from the mom. Dad comes in, wants to get the baby. They say no, he's too pitiful. He can't keep a job. You know, they just don't like him. But they find mom guilty of severe abuse. And she drops out. She signs over her rights, which, interestingly, by the way, we have found on Facebook that she is continuing to have a relationship with the child, this mother who there's a finding severe abuse, and not the dad.
Wow.
So, but anyway, so that's how they keep their numbers up. They judicially, this judicial castration. There's another mom in East Tennessee, and I have followed her case since 2014 when they walked in the hospital 2 days after she had her baby. And she had had a positive drug screen when she was 2 months pregnant, and she'd had one. She had had to take a pain medication, and then about 4 months pregnant. But when the baby's born, it's totally clean. She's clean. No, she'd stopped using, and they took her baby away from her at 2 days, saying that she had had a positive drug screen while she was pregnant. So she's had a trial now, and that's going up to the Court of Appeals. She had an expert come in, a high-risk obstetrician and gynecologist come in and say that there is no evidence to show that baby will have any long-term effects of this. So we'll see if that one will continue to follow. All right. Now, I do want to talk a little bit about creating a force that moves forward. on page 4. So, lots of people contact me all the time, and everybody wants to know about filing a lawsuit against DCS, so we're just going to talk about that for just a minute, because that is like a whole law school class. But I want you to understand that 42 U.S.C. 1983 is the Civil Rights Act. This is the legislation which was passed by the Republicans, by the way.
What was the name? You said it was the name of the what act?
42 U.S.C. 1983.
Is
Civil Rights.
Civil Rights, okay.
The Civil Rights Act was created because although we had freed the slaves in the mid-1800s, we, of course, treated them very poorly for the next 70 years. So the Civil Rights was created so that these people could bring lawsuits against violations of their constitutional right to vote, primarily, is where it started from. But there would be a cause of action against the government.
And that's the 14th Amendment.
Well, it can be any amendment. It can be the 4th Amendment, it can be the 8th Amendment, it can be the 14th Amendment, depending on what it is. But it's a violation of your constitutional rights. So prisoners can sue, for instance, for cruel and inhumane treatment under the 8th Amendment. For parents, there are different, depending on the type of case, but possibly under the 14th or the 4th Amendment. The 4th Amendment being a wrongful search and seizure, and then the 14th Amendment being due process rights, which includes the right to familial rights. All kinds of obstacles in these cases. All kinds of obstacles. You cannot sue the state. Okay, so you cannot sue the state of Tennessee. You cannot sue the Department of Children's Services. You must sue the individuals in our state. Now, in some states like California, and Tennessee used to be this way, the child welfare agencies are county agencies. You can sue a county. You cannot sue the state. So DCS made itself a state agency instead of a county agency to shield it from that type of a lawsuit. So you have to sue the individuals. However, this is where I hope I can go. You can sue a private company who is acting as a government entity. So, some prisoners sued CCA, right? They've sued the medical facilities owned by the state, etc. So you can sue a private agency. So if we can create a cause of action against Omni, against Camelot, against Providence, then for a violation of a constitutional right, then we can bring a civil rights action against them. These folks are smart. They're real smart. Last year. And I talked to her about it. You need to talk to her about it. Representative Sheila Budd, who I like. Nice conservative. Long-term representative. Somebody got in her ear, got her to recommend a bill that these private agencies could not be sued for more than $300,000.
Wow.
That is the same cap that you find on a government tort liability action. It is a statutory thing that says if you go out here and you get hit by a city bus and you need to sue the government on a tort, then there's a cap of $300,000, no matter what it is. Some lobbyist with Omni, with Camelot, with Providence, whoever, Catholic Charities, have gotten in the ear of the legislators that we need to be protected. We need to be protected.
We're stealing a lot of kids. We need protection.
Yeah. We're going to be sued. Somebody's going to sue us, you know.
Wow.
Things happen. You know, kids die. It didn't pass.
Good.
But all I'm right. Sure it'll come up again. Yeah. I saw her at a presentation. I said, Sheila, cannot do this because these people have to be held accountable for what they're doing to children. So that is how they're trying to get around this. Now, there are civil rights is wrongful removal, I believe, fits into that category. And this is due process rights. What I would like to see happen, and it's stewing around in my brain, is a class action lawsuit the opposite of what occurred with Brian A., which was the foster children who needed to be moved to permanency. I believe now children in the foster care system need a class action lawsuit under a 1983 case for wrongful removal and retention and being held captive by the government for too long.
And would you add a layer with the 14th? Because those children are also being kept from all their family. Could that be a component, potentially?
Yeah, but you know, well, no, so what they're going to say as far as this is, because this is due process, so what they're going to say as far as due process is that they had a guardian ad litem, and so they had due process in the system. Okay. So it's once they're in that system.
So it would still be the
fourth. Child did, but what about the parent?
What about if the guardian ad litem is biased to begin with?
Well, then they are.
That's, every time.
Yeah.
There are many
children who get into the system. They're either wrongfully removed or mostly wrongfully retained, wrongfully held captive by a government agency who need to be returned to family members. And the thing about these huge lawsuits, it's better to rifle it than shotgun it, okay?
True.
Because you know how many attorneys they have up in the AG's office? A lot. So every time I get involved with a lawsuit against the state, there's like five attorneys on the other side.
Connie, I have a question.
On a
slow day.
I have a question about these civil rights lawsuits, because I've seen some things that say, well, this wasn't a protected class, so therefore.
This doesn't have anything to do with protected class.
No. Okay, good.
That's discrimination.
Good.
Okay, so there's another part of that, which has now started to surface, same for the Department of Justice, is the ADA actions. I have one currently pending in the federal court. DCS has refused to acknowledge that parents have rights under ADA, which is the American with Disability Act, and yet what they want to claim is that parents are too incompetent to care for their children. So you can't have it both ways. So you can't say that a parent is too incompetent to keep a job, so therefore they can't parent. Because if that parent has a disability that prohibits them from doing any function of daily activity, they qualify under ADA. Under ADA, they're supposed to have an individualized assessment, and they're supposed to have services provided to them that accommodate their needs within that individualized assessment. So this in 2015, there's a case out of Massachusetts called the Sarah Gordon case. And Sarah Gordon was a young mom in her 20s who had some disabilities. And they took her child, said she couldn't parent, put her child in foster care. There's a lot of details, but her mother came along and said, I will take guardianship of the child. My daughter can live with me. She can parent. I'll teach her how to help take care of her child. The state agency said no, because, of course, they wanted to put that child into an adopted home. And so they got somebody to listen at the Department of Justice, who issued a scathing report against the Massachusetts CPS organization, saying that it was a violation of ADA. Shortly after that, this was about February.
Of 2016?
15. In August of 2015, and these are things you can pull off, there is a technical assistance guide that was published by the Department of Justice telling all agencies that the ADA does apply to you. I have filed that in Tennessee, and they have totally ignored it. So I'm trying to get that before the federal court. So that is a huge issue, because, and it's not just parents, but it's children, too. You know, you have children that they take into these agencies, and they say they have severe ADD, or they have, you know, they're too autistic, or they have this problem or that problem. And these children have rights under ADA, again, to have their needs assessed, and then to have them properly accommodated. Now, because we have a hero on the West Coast, I am going to talk just a minute about Sean McMillan, who is going around and helping parents kind of learn how to file their own civil rights actions. Sean has had great success. He had the Fogarty case. I think it's $4.9 million. And he's also worked on several other cases. He has videos and depositions up on YouTube. You can watch these people basically just flat out say that they take children, they don't need a warrant. He's been to Arizona, he's working in California. And then there's another case out of California. He wasn't the attorney of record, but it's called the Hardwick. County of Orange. This is a great case. This is a huge case. It's a huge win. It's out of the Ninth Circuit Court, which is California. And in this case, it says that social workers cannot lie in court to take a child and have immunity. Okay, because...
What was that, January 3rd, 5th, something?
Yeah, it's like the 3rd or something. Yeah, right at the beginning of the year. And so this is huge, because that's the other problem with suing in civil rights cases, is they claim immunity. It has to be called a clearly established right before you can overcome the immunity. There are certain clearly established rights, such as a law enforcement officer walking in your home without a warrant or without consent. But that is something that they try to pull on you every single time. This case is not only great because it says specifically that they cannot have immunity, but it goes through this analysis that if you have a question about whether or not something clearly established, there does not have to be a case on point. If there are other laws, if there are other policies that support that these government workers knew or should have known that this is what they were supposed to do to protect your rights, then they can still be sued. So he's doing a great job, you know. He's never runs out of business out there. I would think they would run and hide from him, but they're still not making any changes, but he's done an incredible job.
Does that include immunity from perjury?
Okay, so criminal versus civil, you know, are two different things. So to do anything criminal, you have to get the district attorney to prosecute. Okay, so civil... So perjury is criminal, but basically in the case I just told you about, the Hardwick case,
it was perjury.
It was perjury.
In front of the court is civil.
Civil.
But it was, but the way it played into this was that it was a civil rights violation to take the child by committing perjury. So what the action was a civil rights violation. Okay. There are also, in our area of the country, there's a case law that says that a negligent investigation can be a violation of your civil rights. Huge for DCS.
Okay, explain that, negligent investigation.
Okay, I'll tell you a little bit about what the specific case is. This is a case out of Kentucky.
Because I have another question that kind of piggybacks on that. You initially began with 80% of the children in foster care are there as a result of neglect.
Yes.
But the word neglect is ambiguous.
Right.
Absolutely.
Right. So there's this case in Kentucky, and basically it stems out of this man who was a counselor at an elementary school. And he takes kids into his office. He counsels with them. He always kind of leaves a door open. But some child made a complaint that he had sexually molested him. And so that, of course, DCS and investigators and everybody goes like freaking crazy over it. They do some stuff, but they're very negligent about what they do. And then this detective goes... Oh, they interviewed some kids who said he'd never hurt them, never bothered them. He also interviewed some people who were in the office who said, you know, the guy always leaves his door open. He doesn't close the door when a child's in there. And so this detective's upset and she's mad because she can't get anywhere with this. So she goes to the magistrate and she gets a warrant against the guy to arrest him for aggravated child sexual abuse. And does not tell the magistrate about the mitigating factors. Doesn't tell the magistrate about... He always keeps the door open and nobody else has said this and all that. Gets a warrant, has the guy arrested, he loses his job. It takes several months for him to get through this. Ultimately, the whole case is dismissed. He sued the detective for negligent investigation. Okay, because she withheld information in prosecuting. Now, remember civil rights, here's another problem. It is a 1-year statute of limitations. 1 year.
From the date
of the injury. This is why it's, you know, DCS drags your case out forever. However, for minor children, in 1 year after they turn 18.
That's why the kids are suing us.
That's why it's so important to pursue in behalf of the children.
I am 4.
Yeah. So bringing a civil rights action is difficult. It's not impossible.
So in the negligent investigation, mm-hmm. that was a law enforcement officer. Would that apply to a social worker
yes.
who's conducting an investigation?
Yes. Yes.
Okay.
Well, that was kind of my question. If a law enforcement officer who's not investigating, but he's part of the case as petitioner, he's trying to get these kids, and he commits perjury on his petition, and he's a law enforcement officer. How do you put that into the middle of the investigation when you have law enforcement lying to the investigators?
The whole system, DCS, guardian ad litem, everybody has been biased for him because he wears that badge.
Mm-hmm.
And they're biased yeah. for children, and I can appreciate that. I would certainly want any child to be, you know, represented.
Yeah, the benefit of the doubt to the child, absolutely.
Yes, and that's where it's being played on, too.
Mm-hmm. When yeah. law enforcement commits perjury to other law enforcement, that's really scary.
Yeah, it is.
It is. I know. Any perjury in an official capacity is scary and damaging.
But would that be criminal? Did he commit criminal perjury?
Yes.
And civil rights perjury?
I think so.
It's
if you can
both.
Prove it, can you prove it?
Oh, yeah. There's documents. He was indicted by the grand jury. I'm pretty sure that
okay.
he said no. He had no criminal involvement.
Wow.
But he was indicted by a grand jury. So, yeah.
Okay, well, all right. So I'm going to talk about a couple more things on page 4 so we can move on. So there are some things that we are doing as far as an organization base, and that is... this has to be broken up into units and to move forward. I've been calculating this in my mind over and over and over. We have, as most people know, we're in here as a group on Facebook called the Family Forward Project. The Family Forward Project is where I just try to keep pounding news events going on all over the country. Try to invite, if you haven't already, friend with your legislators, all your local politicians, and add them to the group. Start putting these people, forcing these people into the group so they can see these massive amount of stories going on all over the country. Hopefully, at some point, this becomes a membership organization in which we can then create lobbying efforts. Secondarily, as we are creating the Family Forward Foundation. The Family Forward Foundation is created as a 501c3. It's still in process. We have our mission
nonprofit.
Statement,
okay.
Nonprofit. We have our mission statement developed. Remember, in a nonprofit, you cannot lobby, you cannot support specific candidates. Therefore, it has to be for education and training. Now you can put together, certain proposed legal things that, you know, such as uniform codes or et cetera, but it has to be really for education and humanitarian. Hopefully then this provides as it expands a little bit, parent advocacy. You know, you can do as a nonprofit as well. We must have a service organization, that can provide services outside of the foster care system for families and make the state, you know, contract to pay those services. I'll talk about that again.
Almost like
second.
A CAC for parents type? Well, not necessarily.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And then, and that's mainly it. Hopefully this... also then creates kind of a legal source, a foundation, either for class actions or for legal training funding for people who represent parents. So as far as folks that we are meeting, talking to, learning about this problem, that's what you have to put into your mind. And that's and what you need to do is to really think about what you're good at, what your talents are. Whether your talent is just time, whether your talent is writing, whether your talent is stuffing an envelope, you know, what is your time? I have a full-time law practice that is very arduous, and I make sure I do at least one thing every day towards this effort, and then usually on the weekend, I make sure I block out a couple hours. I may, you know, it could be writing a blog, it could be studying, collecting cases to study. So you have to dedicate part of your life to this. You have to. People are going to have to put their time and their energy into this effort. Very hard. You got your own cases going on. Very heartbreaking. Very hard to do. You have to take one step past that. Legislation. There's two thoughts about legislation. One is the two different ways to approach legislation. One is to approach legislations on a bits and pieces And there's lots of ways to do bits and pieces. For instance, one thing I think needs to be looked at in Tennessee is under child abuse. They say that, you know, people have to report if there are if there is a medical condition called shaken baby syndrome, okay? This is a misnomer, and it needs to be taken out of the statute because it is not medical evidence, right? The medical evidence is bleeding retinas, you know, subdural hematoma. That is the medical evidence. Shaken baby is just a name we put to it, just like Munchausen, right?
That's a label. Pulled that right out of my head because I was thinking the same thing.
Just like Munchausen's. It is not medical evidence, and so we need to clean up our laws that way. However, there's always an opportunity in legislation to throw in an omnibus. Right, we had a huge one in Tennessee a few years ago called the Civil Justice Act, and it did all kinds of crazy things, putting caps on Med-Mal and making you do certain things for Med-Mal. One of the things that I put together, and actually I think Jenny helped me sort of redefine this, it's in your packet, it's called the Family Integrity Act. And this is 4 pages, and this is omnibus. And this is really about what family integrity should mean as a public policy. Even though the public policy of Tennessee is reunification, they just keep putting roadblocks in front of that. It talks about the obligation and the authority of the courts, the obligation of the state agency and those appointed by the state. There's a lot of things in here about transparency, disclosure, sharing information, the children's rights, and ultimately the parents' rights.
I'm not feeling the love here.
Yeah, it's this packet.
Oh, it's not this packet, huh?
It's in here.
Okay, thank you.
It's really important to read through this and to share this. And we're going to talk about sharing. This is the kind of thing you need to share with your neighbors, the people in church, with your legislators, with school people, and just say, you know, we need to start looking at children's and looking at family integrity and family rights. I'm telling you, they're going after education next, okay? Bill Gates and Stephen Jobs, of course, I guess Stephen Jobs passed away, but, you know, these people want their hands on education. George Soros, all right? They're going after it, okay? They're going after the control of the family. What is the one commodity that's going to be there no matter what changes in technology?
People.
People.
Resource.
People. People.
People.
That is the one commodity. It's never going to change. It's never going to be outdated like a buggy whip. It's never going to be affected by technology like a telephone. It is people. It is our day-to-day lives, our health, our education, the care of our children.
And the goal of industry is to touch the people. So they're reaching far.
Yeah. All right, page 5, what to do as a parent. If you are a parent involved in the system.
This one.
Yeah, sorry. These are the most important tools to have. A tape recorder. Some people record it on their phone now, but this is my favorite because tape recorders plug right into the computer. Can't be downloaded, saved, read.
Oh, I love that.
What brand is that? Give us your...
This is Olympus. They're kind of hard to find. Radio Shack used to carry them.
They just
have
a digital recorder?
Yeah. Their best bet is to find it either in an Amazon or on Staples online. Olympus recorder. Cost you about $100. Worth every dime. All right. Recorder.
So you plug it in and it downloads to your computer and then you can
save it. That's
amazing.
You can
save
it on
software tool where you
YouTube
can download and organize them.
Yeah, but I mean, there's no priority software on this. It's just
it probably has a tool. It's basically a driver. It'll have what it needs just when you plug it in.
And it's so funny how you can just be carrying it around anywhere, and people may or may not realize.
I record everything, every CFTM meeting, every court appearance. I started carrying a recorder around in 2008 after a judge in a courtroom call and a courtroom full of people called me a jerk, and then had a slight memory loss after that. Didn't remember he had done that. Filed a complaint on him. Started carrying a recorder. First time I carried a recorder into a DCS meeting and laid it on the table, they said, you can't record. And I go, why? And they said, because it's confidential. And I said, well, wait a minute. You got somebody on that side of the table making notes that they're going to write down, and they're going to make part of the file for this parent. So I just want to make sure when I get your copy of the notes, they're accurate. It took me out of the room, had me talk to legal, cancel the meeting. Had
that's not when you were arrested.
They didn't want to hide, or they wouldn't, you know, right.
There, it's confidential. I'm like, they reset the meeting 3 weeks later, let me take my recorder in. Ever since, I've not had a problem with it. Record them on the phone, record them in the courtroom. I, you know, if I'm in a courtroom with a judge where there's no tape recorder, now it's you know, they don't seem to mind, but I would always make sure that I would look at the recorder a few times just so the court knew that there was a recorder in the courtroom. Most of the courts in Tennessee on the juvenile court level are supposed to be either audio recorded or video recorded. They don't like to give them to you, so it's best to record on your own. I'm going to tell you something else. There are signs on a lot of these courtrooms now that say no recorders. There's a law on the books that attorneys have the right to record every single proceeding.
And per se, you did per se.
Well, I'm just telling you.
Okay.
On the books, it's the attorney has the right. It certainly, if you are pro se, would be an equal protection issue if you were not allowed to record a proceeding, because it is on the books that any attorney can record any proceeding on their own. Notebooks. I beg my clients, please document everything, everything, everything. A simple spiral notebook for $2 you can use. If you want to be real fancy, you can get a 3-subject one. You can divide it to CPS kids in court. And document, 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 because they are training foster parents to document everything that occurs. Every phone call that you make, every time you visit your kids, so that they can go to court and they can go, on January the 3rd, 2013, Michael was 3 minutes late, and then, let's see, his child acted kind of scared when he saw him. It took a while to warm up, and then he did call him daddy the whole time. Okay? That's how they show it's in the best interest of the child to leave your child in the hands of strangers.
The difference between the foster parent and parent is, I don't know about you guys, but I was so personally devastated that I was practically non-functioning and paralyzed for 6 months, and now I'm being asked to write, and I can't even form a sentence.
I understand. I get it totally. I get it.
We laugh about it now, but at that time, this was soul pain.
Oh, so I know.
Often, also with when your supervised visits, I guess you should document.
Well, immediately after, you wouldn't want to interrupt your visit, but immediately after, say, here's what happened. And if you have a supervisor, it doesn't hurt to ask them, how did it go? What do you think? Right? Ask your supervisor. Say, can I get a copy of your notes? But I'm going to tell you, you are absolutely right. It is disgusting. It is embarrassing. It is...
No, it's just not embarrassing.
Draining.
It's even come into
it. It was like, I was in shock.
Yeah.
I was mortified. I served 20 years in the military, defending everybody's way of life. And then I'm having my children taken away from me.
Yeah. I know. It's devastating. And that is why...
Without any explanation. And I didn't see them for 3 months. I didn't know if they were alive or dead.
And this is done by people who swear to support the Constitution.
And as a grandparent, you have no rights. If they take this child away... I don't get nothing.
And I've heard one story after another, and that just breaks my heart, because you have somebody now that's older, wiser, made all the mistakes, you know, probably as an 60% dysfunctional as they were when they were younger, and with the right kind of, you know, advocacy and support services.
For grandparents, you lose your own child.
In Kentucky, there's no such thing as grandparent rights. None.
And your grandchildren, you get hit a double whammy. Because I have to help her, and then I'm trying to help them. Then they come to you and say, choose your own job or your grandkids.
I know.
Yes.
I know.
Oh, they made me choose between one child or the other.
You can't.
And if I took one, I couldn't have this one. If I had this one, I couldn't take that one.
I know, exactly.
And then dropped him.
I don't have him.
I know. I know.
We got to do something about the drugging, two of our kids in these facilities.
Yeah. Parent advocacy. Have to. You know, but parents have got to write it down. You've got to write it down. You have to write it down. You have to write it down.
Your side just disappears. They take them off the case. They put somebody else on
right.
It.
Yeah. Or you can't get copies of papers, or you can't get them to talk to you because you're not in the case.
No, yeah.
I'm not in the case.
As a grandparent.
I have no
right.
I'm not in the case. So I filed a petition
get in the case.
And as a parent, you get ping pong back and forth. Well, they say you're not there, the case is closed, but you still have to do all this over here.
I went
ping pong back and forth.
I went to a CASA meeting. The supervisor was there, or the social worker. And she comes walking down the stairs. She says, oh, so I didn't think you were going to be here today. Well, whatever made you think that? I said it very clearly yesterday when I called and spoke to you that I would be here today. And so we get on upstairs, and then you have these CASA workers just laughing at me because you're telling us in one hand that you have a problem child, but we're doing what we need to do to help that child. But yeah, but you're sitting there laughing at me isn't helping.
Right.
And the way they degrade you during these meetings when they just pop up out of nowhere in your home or, you know, talk to you during these meetings in the building, I mean, customer service skills in America suck, really.
Yeah.
Do.
Or don't even get a CASA.
It's highly polished and refined.
CASA's in on it, too.
I can't stand CASA.
Okay. All right. A couple other things. Again, not only are you documenting just what's occurring, you need to start creating, and of course, I'm a chart organized, you know, hyper OCD organized person. Creating charts, make sure you write down your witnesses, who's somebody who can come and testify. This is this is really over the top OCD, but I like charted all the DCS records in this one case from 2011 to 2015. And the reason why it was so important ultimately is in this last thing where I was putting my notes, the children had been in 13 placements and showed all the reasons for removal. So, so this included Omni and supervised visits. I'll tell you what happened. I gave this to DCS. I gave them a copy of it. Right after this, Omni stopped putting their notes in the records. they stopped giving it to me. Now they're, but documenting. As a professional, Jenny is active working with me on the Family Forward Foundation. We're also working with Maureen O'Neill and Lisa Vincent out of Connecticut. I met Maureen and Lisa when I went to Washington last February, and we went to some senators and congressmen's office, and they're very active in that area. I see professionals emerge, and I see attorneys from different parts of the state. I've seen doctors. I've seen other activists. We don't really have a real centralized database so that we can have a symposium or a meeting or a force that we can put behind some of these parents. I mean, if we have a force of professionals under the Family Forward Foundation that can enter into a case and just say, you know, the foundation is looking at this case or reviewing that case and, you know, we want to make sure everything's on track, then it will strengthen parents with a collective mind.
Right.
So we're working on creating a...
Now, I thought you were linked up with Kathy Arthur?
Kathleen Arthur.
She's in Washington, too, isn't she?
Well, she's from Oregon. She lives in Oregon. Okay. But I met up with her up there in Washington, and she was helping doing some lobbying. with attorneys and media... medical lawmakers. I've been doing some speaking. I've posted my indigent passport talk. It's about 10 minutes. It's great to pass around to people. It's 10 minutes. It's right on point. I repost it once in a while, and you need to share it with everybody because it really gets down to the nitty gritty of what's going on. The Molly Tierney TED Talk video on YouTube. I repost that once in a while. Molly has been a commissioner over there, Child Welfare Services up there. She tells it like it is, that foster care does not work. And it's damaging. It's long term. I hope to, in what I'm doing, I hope to be able to create some training programs for attorneys who want to defend parents, and that they are more equipped, that they can use that as their CLE, and also to create a training for parents. Parents have got to get, just like you said, you're so devastated, what do I do, where do I go, are these people helping me, hurting me? You don't even realize how much harm it's going to be. Some people get into this system and they're like, you know, my kid missed the dental appointment, I was late for school 3 times, you know, surely I'm not a bad parent, right? And then it just steamrolls out of control. There's a family in Florida, they're on Facebook with us, Freddie and Tracy Versosa, and I've got them on my iPad. They were in Washington with us. Tracy has high functioning autism. She's so sweet. She's had 7 children. But she cares for all these children. She has been an amazing mother. And Freddie, they moved from North Carolina to Florida. Freddie is a does carpentry and home repairs. He was kind of slow. His work was kind of slow for a while. They were having trouble getting started. They contacted the social services and told them they needed a transportation to a medical appointment for one of their children. One of the middle children had a heart murmur. And so they said, okay. And so they scheduled this appointment, scheduled transportation for them, and they don't show up. And so they start walking. Of course, they don't make it to the appointment. But 2 days later, CPS shows up at the doorstep and says they're negligent for missing a doctor's appointment. They've had their children now, all of their children, for 2.5 years, and won't give them back.
They are still get to see them, right?
And then they always tell you, you don't know the whole story.
Exactly. So, and I've had quite a long conversation with him. We're trying to give him some tools to help himself. The Declaration of Parents' Rights I put in here, something that my list, where's my list?
I did see that.
So the Declaration of Parents' Rights, I just think parents need to have a copy of this. I've put it up in the files. A lot of people have put in a lot of stuff in our files on innocent families, so it's kind of hard to find when you get there. But really, every parent needs to fill this out and needs to put this in their file, and they need to file it in their case. And I'm going to make a declaration of my right to parent my child. The other thing that I think is important to do is to do an affidavit of facts and put your affidavit of facts to file it in the file. You want to be kind of careful and make sure it's accurate and that, you know, they'll try to use it against you, so you want to be careful about that. But I've had many parents tell me that they never got all of their facts, all their information into the record, and so it's important to have it into the record. All right, so as we wind up, and I want to again just thank everybody for just taking a stand, standing up. I want to talk about, there's some other things legally, I think, that are kind of pending out there. There's no uniform code for family law. There are uniform codes for commercial law, for trust law, for banking. There's no uniform code for family law. There's this organization called the Uniform Code Commission. I don't know who creates them, but they look at this uniform codes. And at one point, they tried to do it for marriage, but for all the states, and it really failed. But the laws are so different in every state, and I've heard, and I get bits and pieces of information of attorneys that I connect to in different states. And in California, the burden of proof to terminate your parental rights is a preponderance of evidence.
That is in 90% of the states.
Why, don't you need evidence?
But preponderance of the evidence is like one of the lowest standards.
That's like one step clear and convincing.
Or one step up from probable cause is nothing.
So, well, you have actually, from a...
False accusations could constitute probable cause.
So, from a legal mind... This is enough for a police officer to stop you on the street and frisk you or ask you questions or look in your car and see if you have drugs in your car. So that's a reasonable suspicion. Probable cause is enough to get you arrested. It's also enough to take your child. But it's supposed to be immediate threat of harm.
The probable cause of immediate threat.
Yeah, it's supposed to be. The next one is preponderance of evidence. And all you need is preponderance of evidence to get your damages in a car wreck. Okay. The next one is called clear and convincing. Clear and convincing is what you need to prove fraud. It's what you need for a will contest. And it's what you need to find that you are a bad parent.
Can you determine clear and convincing without a hearing and testimony?
No. And then, of course, the highest is beyond a reasonable doubt, and this is criminal.
Is there anything we can do to find out why the woman that removed our children got fired?
Talk to her.
All the ones involved, all the way up to the directors, are no longer working for DCBS.
Okay, so...
I may not have won the war, but I did win the battles.
All right, so another important thing. There's so much information here. ICWA, the Indian Child Welfare Act. In an ICWA case, the burden of proof
you're supposed to have, yeah,
is beyond a reasonable doubt.
For a child removal or
to find your bad parent.
Oh, a bad parent. Mm-hmm.
And it has to be by expert testimony.
Well, they got mine on dependency through no fault of the parent. My daughter attempted suicide.
Mm-hmm.
It was, I'm not going to try to minimize the severity.
Okay, hold on. You're correct. Dependent neglect action is an action that determines the status of the child, and it is clear and convincing that a child is dependent neglect. It does not have to be against a parent. So we'll just, that just, yeah, you're right. So it's bad parent or dependency and neglect, period. Now, some states have lowered the burden to preponderance of the evidence, even though there's a United States Supreme Court case that says it's supposed to be clear and convincing. ICWA says for an Indian heritage, it has to be beyond a reasonable doubt. For constitutional scholars, that's an equal protection violation.
Absolutely.
Why is an Indian's, a Native American Indian's right to parent or the right to familial integrity any
greater?
Are different or more sacred than that of you and I.
So that would be a discrimination, because that's
it's not discrimination. No, don't talk discrimination. No. That's the whole protected class thing. It's equal protection.
Okay.
All right. So this is I'm going to raise in the next case I get. So, but this lowering it to a preponderance of the evidence in California. And there's an attorney out there I've had some discussions with. She says, well, the courts have decided that since they've already decided you're a bad parent by clear and convincing evidence, that basically all we're determining by a preponderance of evidence is that the kid will be better off someplace else. So, now, the family rights, family parental rights organization is a little bit in flux right now, but they have recommended, where's my eraser?
By the
iPad. The parental rights organization,
parentalrights.org
has lost their big advocate, Mike Ferris. He's moved someplace else. But they are trying to promote that every state pass a constitutional amendment for the right to parent. Constitutional amendment. It's hard to get a constitutional amendment passed. There's a few states that have done it. There's probably about six. The reason, what would that do? That would mean you have a constitutional right to parent. Mm-hmm. Prisoners have more rights than parents do.
It's true.
Criminals have more rights than parents. They have rights to be free from cruel and unusual punishment. They have due process rights, the right to confront the accusers. Okay, criminals have more rights. So if we can get a constitutional amendment for the right to parent, then your rights would be elevated. Okay, so it's important to think about that. We haven't really done that at this point in Tennessee.
But that's in how many states?
It's about six. You can go to their website and you can see.
Oh, the Parents' Rights, the website.
Yeah. All right, now as we begin.
It's a good organization.
I'm in it.
I think there are some, we need to just start hitting. We've got to start communicating, hitting. Grow in organizational strength. We have got to. We're going to get these letters out, send the email to the White House. I think the number one thing, again, to just hit them with is banning the adoption bonus money.
Mm-hmm.
It is a crime against humanity.
Yep.
No cash, no incentive.
Our kids out there getting a big score.
Absolutely.
I just think that people don't know about it. People knew.
People do not know.
I didn't know until this past year.
Well, you also wouldn't
thing,
believe it.
It's the same thing with the special needs circle and
you
family.
Don't learn this thing until you slip into it.
They're doing big autism movements and things of that nature. That's kind of where I came from is knowing how to get to there. It started with three parents, and now it's over 3 million parents.
Exactly.
And it's a word of mouth, and it's an army of advocates training other ones, going
right.
and doing.
Well, they've got 4 million. We need to get our 4 million.
Right.
Well, I'm in groups with about 6,000 people that
right.
kids have autism because my son has autism.
Yeah.
And
right.
I advocate.
And I will tell you, we have a hurdle to go over. We have a hurdle. That hurdle is nobody wants a child to be abused. Right? Mm-hmm. Everybody wants a child to
and
be
I'm
safe.
I understand
secure.
That.
Right.
I don't. We
well,
all feel the same way.
The system is
abusive.
Just like you do. You always start with that.
emotionally.
But people don't know that. They think these agencies that are supposed to be protecting the kids are protecting the kids.
Right.
That's the general.
It's a reverse blind, is what they call it.
It's conventional
wisdom
says.
It's where you're looking in a two-way mirror. They're trying to protect the children, the right so thing. They say of the children they're actually not protecting. So it's like a two-way
right.
mirror. It's a reverse blind, is what they call it.
And that's why it's very important to every news story that you see, scout forums, scour the internet forum, every news story you see about social workers being arrested or foster children being murdered.
That's my mission once a month, I Google. I really do.
You know, we have got to post all these stories, post them in Family Forward, just post them. You know, the Chronicle for Social Change is a great online
paper. But can you now pay for it to see their articles?
Well, they haven't made me pay yet, so I don't. Maybe there's so many out there. But they write really, well, he writes pretty good articles. They've kind of changed a little bit. BuzzFeed, there's a writer on there. I've got one of his articles here. Aaron Roston. I mean, there's some writers out there who really get it, who are watching the stories. Locally, we have some people. A Tennessean has a pretty good writer. She got to post these stories, post them. We've got to have this centralized place where these stories from all over the country, and then it will start to bubble up. Arkansas is a mess right now. Arizona, they're investigating. It's a mess right now. Iowa, so
Kansas.
Just, yeah.
How can we find families? The way the special needs work is you go to an IEP meeting at school and you know there's another one behind you. You hang around the lobby and watch the parent come out. Go, hey, hi, my name's... Yeah, and then it starts...
How many of you walk in the courthouse?
But how do you know which one of them are there for...
It's not like we don't know what day to be there.
I mean...
But you know what? It doesn't hurt to ask.
That's what I'm saying. Can you just kind of walk up and say, hey...
Now, I've got... Well, I'm telling you...
Trust anybody inside the courthouse.
I've got, and y'all can take a handful of them, a flyer that you can, just says, basically, when this much of what we talked about today. But I have a flyer you can take and you can hand out, you know.
And I got some VistaPrints cards that when I'm at the juvenile court and I hear something's going on, I say, you know, get in touch with.
Hand it out.
I've been trained by an organization that I'm no longer affiliated with, but... Everybody knows who I am as an advocate.
You can say, are you in Tennessee, you can say, are you involved with DCS? Are you involved in a DCS case? I mean, you can ask that.
I had a form created that I had my daughter fill out, that I filled out after every meeting that we had visitation, because they were twist and turn things. They stopped me from using that form. Okay, they stopped me. My daughter had said it was a great visit. Okay, three times in a row, they got wind of it that I had these forms, and there was like, no, you can't bring them in here. Right. Why? You're telling me my daughter didn't have a pleasant visit.
Your daughter can't take her own notes during a visit.
Like, it was teenage rebel against mom, okay? Mm-hmm. But, I mean, I've even made my own forms and just simple check mark, and they told me, no, I can't do it.
There are some, so
I can make forms.
So make forms, reach out to other people. We have got to continue to grow. It just has to continue to grow. And it's out there. That medicalkidnap.com is a great, they write great articles on there. Post them, share them, post them. She writes these great stories about the parents losing their children for, you know, broken ribs when the baby was vitamin D deficient and stuff. So they are writing some great stories. And just keep sharing, reaching out. Like I said, I've got some flyers. I'm on several radio shows. I've been on Dave Perkins. I've been on David Tullis. I've been on Josh Bernstein. I've been in Pennsylvania. So we've got to keep talking about it. So, you know, it has to grow. It has to become a force. And, I mean, again, there's 400,000 children. Now, you know, 50,000 of those children probably should be removed. You know, 50,000 of them, maybe.
Right. I agree.
But there's 300,000 children.
And that's what makes it so hard for us parents. Worry about. We needed some intervention, yes. Did we need our children removed to 2 years? Not see them? No.
I have, and we have to have stats. I have gone, I've talked. It's very, you know, when you go to a legislature, and you want to talk to them, they want to know one of two things. Either that's how many votes you have behind you, mm-hmm. or how much money you have to give them. Mm-hmm. Okay, money and votes. So when I went up to Washington, D.C. last February, walked in the office, I said, "Oh, my name is Connie Reguli. I'm here to talk to you about child welfare reform, and I represent a grassroots effort that has grown in social media to over 6,000 people." And they go, "Oh, come on in." Okay? We already have numbers, all right? And we may not be able to hang out a membership card yet, but we already have numbers. So you have got to learn to say that. And you can say it to people that you meet. Just say, you know, there is a growing force of people. I mean, Donald Trump won when everybody said he was going to lose. And he won because people got the guts to stand up. And stand up against their
and look at the like the same-sex marriage things. Whoever thought that would happen, and how many people did it take to make that happen?
How many children were removed because they were in a same-sex marriage?
Yeah, years ago.
Parents.
Things can definitely be turned around.
Do you have a list of community resources like that you could partner with for the foundation?
No. A simple answer. No, I do not. I have had a very difficult time, even as an attorney, finding any type of those community resources. I do think, and let me tell you, and kind of go back to the organizational part of it, part of it is to really create services, assessments, plans. I have some people interested in helping pull that together. One of them is somebody who's done that and has programs. I think that people will, once they see... A lot of people hate DCS, so once they begin to see that there's some force and there's some professionals behind it, I think that's
what a lot of people are waiting for, because the last thing I wanted to do, and this was 3 years ago, 4 years ago starting, I met a lot of angry parents that weren't mm-hmm. of no help. Mm-hmm. Okay, we can sit there and we can tell our story and we can
rant and rave,
but I really wanted solutions, so I got tired of dealing even with Facebook, and I started writing my legislator directly and the director directly. You know, I got tired of working with, like in your situation, working with people down here that was like, "I don't know it. This is the way it's always been, and that's the way it's always going to be. I will not accept that."
Right.
It's not the way
it's going. And it's very difficult for parents who get caught and trapped in the system to separate themselves enough to be able to have some feel like they can move forward logically and chip away at it one part at a time. There's no doubt. Now, I have an account with SurveyMonkey, and I had passed this survey around. And so, you know, part of the good news about Facebook is that you can post a lot of things and stay current. The bad news about Facebook is that once those things slide down the scale, like 3 days, yeah. like they're lost, right?
12 hours.
Yeah. So part of what our websites with the Family Forward Project and Family Forward Foundation is, some of these things will be put onto that website, and then we can just repost that website link once in a while so that we keep, you know, getting more and more survey results and stuff. But basically, I asked questions like, if you had been involved with a Child Protective Services state agency.
That was your pin post that you had on something.
And then it says, if you were placed under a permanency plan or family services plan, you know, most people said yes. I said, did the state agency fairly evaluate the needs of your family? They said no. Were the requirements of the plans related to the reason the child were removed? Most people said no. Did the resources provided satisfy the agency once you engaged the services? Most people said no. In your opinion, did the state agency appear to be sabotaging your ability to complete the requirements? Most people said yes. Yeah. Did the agency do their part in providing you all the resources needed? They said, most people said no. Did you complete the services set forth on the plan? Most people said yes. Were your children returned to you, your care and control at the end of the plan? Most people said no. Mm-hmm. Were you treated fairly through the process? Most people said no. So
they're taking these statistics from their perspective and justifying that money. We need to take these statistics
right.
and say, this is why you don't need the money.
Well, and there are, every once in a while I get a glimmer of hope from the courts. One of them is, there's a couple cases this year. One of them is a case that said that the PERM plan must be clear and specific and, you know, have the goals clearly laid out. So
was that an appeals case? Mm-hmm. I read that one.
Mm-hmm. Ours kept changing.
Yeah, exactly. And that's what they do.
Can you have a permanency plan go with an open hearing and the case be closed?
Permanency plan goal of what?
A psychosexual evaluation. Someone's required to get a psychosexual evaluation, but the caseworker won't pay for it. DCS won't pay for it on the permanency plan because she says the case is closed now. Right. But the hearing's still wide open. The final hearing on abuse is not even finished yet. There's that ping pong again. Mm-hmm. And I'm trying to figure out how to help.
Right.
Like, how can you get one thing when they...
Does the biological parent not have any choice as to who the guardian ad litem is for the children?
No.
Absolutely not?
No. And they should. Yeah, you should be able to remove a guardian ad litem.
Right.
I was told that I could hire my son's own guardian. I could hire their guardian ad litem.
Their own attorney.
Why can't we? We haven't lost my rights yet. I'm still their parent.
Right.
You don't choose who prosecutes you. Okay.
They're supposed to work for my children, not the foster parents.
Right. No, the child's an attorney.
If you can hire...
That's not what it works.
Okay, so as far as online, let's go offline. So, because we've been going on a long time, the people that are hanging in there are probably getting tired, too.